Hey everyone, I'm Xylo Aria and today I have the new Launchkey Mark III. So this is a Launchkey 61. They also come in the 25, 37, 49 and 61 as well. So I just wanted to go through with you exactly how to use this. And there are some really cool functions that they've included in the Mark III that weren't there in the Mark II. But it might be a little bit difficult to get your head around if you're just kind of having a fiddle around. But once you know the basics of how to use it, it is pretty intuitive. So this has kind of been built to work with Ableton. So I will use Ableton to explain that as well. It does work with other DAWs, but I think this is really perfect for Ableton. So firstly, when you plug that in, you just got to see the settings on your Ableton of how to set this up. So if you go into preferences and then you go into the MIDI, I've got the Launchkey settings like this. So that's what worked for me. And yeah, so you can just have a look at that and set yours up the same way. Yeah, and now you're pretty much ready to go with that. So let's just look at what exactly is included. So here there's a few kind of main control functions. Then you've got your pots up the top, you've got your pads down the bottom, you've got the faders here and some transport controls over here. So let's start with this section here. So here you've got the screen, which is awesome. So you can see what you're doing here, which there was a screen in the last one, but it wasn't that great. So then you've got the shift button. This is where you access the functions of what each part of the keyboard is controlling. So in here, you can look into what your pads, pots, and your faders do as well. So we'll have a look at that. And then in your settings, you can go into this and actually customize parts of the keyboard. So, you know, in here, it'll tell you what you're looking at. So you can change your channels for the MIDI. You can change things like aftertouch and your brightness for the pads and things. So I'll leave you to kind of explore that, but I haven't really changed any settings there and just kept them normal. With these, you can scroll across on your tracks. And then with this function here, this kind of acts like kind of like a mouse in a way. So if you go into your browser, you can actually scroll through sounds. And you know, if you press enter, then, which is this key here, it actually enters that into a new track. So that's a really cool function to have, and it stops you from kind of looking at your computer all the time. And then this is your fixed chord function. So with that pressed down, you can actually press a number of different keys, up to six, and the screen will tell you what exactly you've pressed. And then every key that you press will trigger that same chord interval that you added. So that's a pretty cool function. And then you've got your arpeggiator. So in your arpeggiator, when I press this, you'll see that a bunch of different settings come up. So in the arpeggiator, you can control the settings using your keys down here, or your pads and your pots as well. So there's lots that you can do. What you control with your keys and what you control with your pads are actually the same. So it's just the way that you go about doing it. So in the keys, you've got the type of arpeggiator. So you've got a few settings here. You've got the rate, a few settings there, and your octaves, how many octaves you want, and the rhythm as well. So you need to choose something from each one of those settings. So this is the same as the pads. So if I go into arp, you can see the first thing when I press it, it says type. So it's got the same thing. So up, down, played, whatever it is. And then the next thing here, when I click that, is the rate. So again, you've got your rates. So quarter, eighth, 16th, whatever it is. And then the next thing you've got, octave. So yeah, so you can scroll through these functions up here as well. So if I use my keys to select these, if I press shift, and I say I want something that goes up with a 16th note and two octaves, and then that's kind of what's set for you. And then you can actually, in your pad settings, latch that. So when that is turned on, when I play, you don't actually have to hold it down and it will keep playing. You can turn that off as well. And when that's played, you can use these pots to change what's going on the fly. So there's tempo, there's swing, there is gate, and there's mutate, and there's deviate. So mutate and deviate will change around kind of the arpeggiation as well. So that is all the functions in your arp. And then you can go into scale mode. So this is probably my favorite function in the keyboard. So with the scale mode, you will never be able to play out of scale, which is really handy if you're playing live and that's something you're worried about. So what happens with that is when you press shift and scale, then the scale menu comes up. So with this, you can change the kind of scale. So this will tell you what you're looking at. So minor, major, Dorian, there's a few other ones. And then when you press the key, so C, D, E, whatever it is, it sets the root note of the scale. So now we are at C minor. So if I play my keys, you can see that the D sharp and the E are playing the same note because it is playing everything in a C minor. So when that's on and your arp is on as well, your arpeggiation will always be in key as well, which is really handy. So those are those two things there. And then your plus and your minus just goes up octaves. So yeah, you've got that as well. Then you've got your pitch wheel and the modulation wheel. I think I've got nothing to modulate there. But yeah, so that's pretty much that section. On the top here, let's look at the pads first. So with the pads, if you go into shift, so when I press shift, you'll notice that a few things light up here. The blue things up the top control what the pots do. The green things control what the pads do. And then these things control what your faders do. So if we're looking at the pads first, you have a few options here. You've got session, drum, scale chord, and user chord. So the first one, if I go into session mode, then these 16 pads will represent two scenes in your Ableton session mode. So as you can see in the session view, I've got two things in track 4 and 5, two clips. So I can either trigger each clip separately, or I can also trigger the whole thing. So so that's how you use the session mode. But then with this bottom thing here, if I had clips down the bottom, you'd see them here as well in your second scene. But you can also use this as a stop, solo, or mute button as well. So that's really cool. So say we've got this in stop mode, we're playing this, you can actually stop those clips as well. So if it's in solo mode, then you can solo them. Or if you are in mute mode, then it can mute certain tracks as well. And then you can press it again and you'll go back to your session view. So that's really handy. And then if we go into the second thing, you've got drums. So this will act just like a drum pad. So if I go into something that has drums, just acts like your drum pad and you can scroll through your samples with these two arrows, so that's cool. And then the next thing, if you go into scale chord mode, there's a lot of different chords that they've integrated that you can play around with. So here you kind of have four pages of different chords. So, and they will change according to the scale that you're in as well. So the first one is your basic triads, and then you've got sevenths up here. And then if you go down one, you've got ninths. So again, in the screen, it tells you what you're looking at. So you've got ninths and then you've got sixths, ninths in the last page. So that's your scale chord. And then if we go shift again and use a chord, you can actually program these pads into whatever chords that you want. So if we are in user chord mode, we just hold something down and then press all the keys that you want in that chord. And then you can kind of, program these how you want them, up to six keys. So if you want to delete that, just hold this down and press them again and it deletes it. So you've got All those options, so session, drum, scale chord, and user chord. And then you've got four different custom modes. So if you go into Novation's components, so it's either online or you can download their standalone components. With that, you can program what your pads do. So you have four different pages of settings that you can use there as well. And then if we go into your pots, we go into shift. So remember, these are your pots. So if we go into device, then this controls all the little knobs in your device, right? So you can also in your device select what you're looking at. So if we hold down this device select, then so I've got a grand piano and a reverb in there, so I can change between what I'm selecting. So also in your reverb, you know, you have a lot more settings that you can change around. So you've got three different pages here. So in the first one, I'm using the first knob, it's changing something. In the second page, it's changing something else. The last page, it's changing something else. So like for example, if we're changing the wet dry, and say you don't want to, you don't want that to change when you move around in the tracks, you can also lock that device. So now that device is locked. So this changes the wet dry. And if I move to another track, if I change this, it's still changing the wet dry in the reverb. It hasn't moved on. So that's a way to kind of keep control on the same thing. And then you can press it again and that takes off your device lock. So that's your device. So the next thing is your volume. So when you have volume, that's pretty self-explanatory. This moves up and down all your volume faders in the first eight tracks. And then you've got panning, and you can see that that's changing around the panning in your different tracks. And then you've got your sends as well. So again, you've got your send A and B. So now I'm changing the send A, and I would, if you press it again, it will go to send B, but that is now being controlled by the faders. So I'll get into what I mean by that. But then you've got your four different pads here. So again, if you go into components and change around what these pads are, then that gives you four more ways to control what your pots do. So that's pretty much it up to here. So with this, you've got your faders. So you've got eight faders for eight tracks, and then you've got your master fader as well. So with these, if you press shift again, you have access to what they do. So you've got device, volume, send A and send B. And one thing to note is that what this is controlling cannot also be controlled by the pots. So say this is on volume, you can't also select volume on the pots. So so it shows you in orange what is controlling what. So again, we have device, you can change around what your device is doing with these. You have the volume, and then that becomes a volume fader for your different tracks. And then you've got send A and send B as well. So now that's changing send B on track four. And then again, like the pots and the pads, you've got four different custom ways of how these faders are used, which you can go into components and change that around as well. And then you've got this arm select button. So with this, when this is off, then clicking these things is going to change which track is being selected for arming to record. If you press it again, then this becomes select. So this basically, you can just select between tracks. So it's a little bit like scrolling with your tracks, but you can kind of jump around a bit more with these. So that's your arm select button. And then with these are your transport buttons. And these are pretty self-explanatory. So you've got your play, you've got your stop, you've got your record as well, and you've got the loop on and off. So all of these were in the previous model. These four are new. So say you are playing something that you really liked and you forgot to record it. If you go into capture MIDI, then it actually captures the thing that you played. So they are the chords that I played. And if you want to quantize that, then you can just press this quantize and that will snap everything to the beat. So that's really handy to have. And then this has quick access to your click. So when I press that, you can see the click turning on and off. And then you've got your undo button. So that just undoes the last thing that you did. So if I press it once, it's undone the quantize. And then again, it's undone the recording. So that's pretty much all the functions covered there. So if you have any questions or you're not sure of how to use something, let me know in the comments and I can help you. And yeah, let me know what you think of the keyboard as well. And yeah, if you like the video, please subscribe to the channel. And yeah, hope you have a great day.